Hey, Tequila Sean here, founder, mentor, and facilitator of Be Still Devotional Growth Workbook and Bible Study Series. And we are about to begin week number six, day number three. We are walking out this tactical of praise. And we're gonna dive in a little bit deeper in this study tonight and just continue to learn why we praise and what our purpose and reason of praising is, and most importantly, who we give our praise to. So again, we are gonna be diving into week number six, day number three, in this devotional growth Bible study and workbook series, where we are learning to walk out the Word of God. We have been going over this 7 week, once we finish this 7 week study, I always have that light glare in there, but we've been walking out this workbook with 7 weeks of tacticals and studies. I see you, babe. Hey, Monica, you're the first one here. And we have just been going through these 7 tacticals that God gave me in reference to his desire for us to walk out victories. Basically, he has given us authority and he has given us power and he has given us the blueprint for victory. He did not say that we would not fight battles. As a matter of fact, we've been talking about Joshua and how he was told he'd be given the promised land, but God basically told him, you're gonna fight some battles, but all I need you to do is only be strong and of good courage. And so we are walking out these tacticals and we are learning how to be just like Joshua basically, and listen to God, and our instructions are to be still. And we've just been learning that wrapped in the phrase be still is all encompassing of these 7 tacticals to surrender, submit, obey, faith, prayer, praise, and worship. And again, we are on week 6, where we are walking out and talking about praise. And we're going to go ahead and jump into this. Good, I'm glad. It seems like a couple of people got theirs today. I sent those almost 2 weeks ago, so the mail system is definitely working slower than we're used to it, but I'm glad you got it. So I'm gonna go ahead and get into prayer, and we're gonna jump into this study on praise. We'll be going over worksheet number 31, and we will dive into the word in this Bible study in which we study the Bible. So let's go ahead and open up with prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I just come before your throne right now, Father, just giving you all reverence, praise, glory, and honor, Lord, because you are a good God. You are Savior. You are King. You are Healer. You are Deliverer. You are Strength. You are Peace. You are exactly everything and all that we need, Father God. And so as we come before your throne, we recognize and we reverence who we are coming before, because Father, you have taught us that we can only receive when we know who we are receiving from. So Lord, we just praise you. We take a moment to give you thanks. We take a moment to honor you. We take a moment to tell you that we love you. We take a moment to tell you that we appreciate you, Father. We appreciate what you are doing and how you are doing it. And we just give you glory, God. We just think on your goodness. We think on your mercy. We think on your loving kindness towards us, your peace. We think on how day by day, no matter what we are enduring, no matter what we are facing, each and every day, you give us the strength to get up and put one foot in front of the other. And that, Lord God, is after you bless us to open our eyes. And because you do that, we know that there is yet still purpose in our body. So, Father, we will give you glory and we will give you praise just as we think on that, Father God. Thank you for waking us this morning. Thank you, Lord God, for just giving us the power and the ability to do this, to hear, to see, Father God. Lord, we just thank you right now, Lord. And I thank you for all those that will log on, all those that have logged on, and all those that will come, and those that are listening on the podcast and watching on other channels, platforms, and outlets, Father God. I pray your presence and your peace go into their homes. I pray your presence and your peace go into their places of employment, in their vehicles, wherever they are, Father God, just let your word and your presence fall fresh upon their spirit, Lord God. Rejuvenate and restore, Lord God, any burdens. You said my yoke is easy and my burden is light, Father God. So I thank you that you are lifting that burden right now, Father God, that you are just giving them ease, Lord God, that you are just pressing into their presence as they thirst and hunger and desire more of you, Father God. Now, as you speak the word tonight, Father, I yield to you completely, Lord God, all of you and none of me, according to John 3:30, I must decrease that you might increase. So Father God, you have your way. This is your platform, Lord God. I am your vessel. I yield to you, Father God. Use me for your glory, and that let the words that you minister through me be truth and life, for you said in your word, they are spirit and they are life. So Father God, as the Spirit speaks, speak to the Spirit and minister to the spirit of the people. Father, I bind the hand and plan of Satan. I bind misunderstanding. I bind miscommunication. I bind frustration and discord within the word, Lord God. I loose and I release, Father God, your understanding. Speak to us with ease and in simplicity, with clarity of the word, Father God, so that it may be received, Lord God, and that even the smallest of hearers, the smallest of children can understand what you're saying, Father God, so that we can catch a hold of these principles, take it, apply it, and run with it. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Hey, hey, hey. All right. Hello, hello, hello. Hey, Cherry. Hey, Arthenia. Hey, Mama Leslie. Hey, Kimberly. All right. Let's get into the study of a word. Guys, I look like a girl today. I had to do some, I'm in a different setting right now. And I also had to go out and do some recording for the salon. As you know, I'm in the beauty industry also, and this is the first time, literally, I say 7 weeks, but it's probably been longer than that. Quarantine has given me an excuse to not wear makeup, and but I probably hadn't worn makeup all year, but I had to get out and do some stuff in the beauty industry to represent my salon and my brand. So I figured I would pull myself together just a little bit. But anyway, we're gonna get into the word, and let's talk about worksheet number 13, which is gonna be a recap. We're gonna continue to talk about praise. Last night, let's see, we went over worksheet number 30, where we read 2 Samuel. Let me address this again. Last night, I said that on your opening page, which is your intro sheet in your workbook, which is your intro to praise, I said I had made an error. I noticed when I was going back and I was watching the replay, because I always go back to these and listen and study and glean and learn myself. And I noticed that I kept saying 1 Samuel, and we are not in 1 Samuel. That should be 2 Samuel. I did correct it on the digital upload, but if you already printed it out, it's gonna say 1 Samuel, just corrected. But if you were like flipping through and like, what in the world is she talking about? It doesn't say that in 1 Samuel. Yep, you're never going to find it, because it does not say it there. So it should be 2 Samuel. And I noticed that is the only place I had an error. I corrected that in the digital upload. But in your workbook, correct that if you were wondering what's going on there. So we've been teaching from our theme scripture, which is our foundation scripture. We always have a foundation scripture that we build upon, and we give supporting scripture that gives us our definition as we just pull apart and dissect that scripture, deconstruct it, read it front to back, and just absorb it and get into our spirit so that we understand it. And that is the purpose of Bible study, in which we study the Bible, is because we want to understand the word. We don't want to just read the word. It says that we should be doers of the word. So in order to do, not just hear it, we should hear it. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, but we are required to do. And in order to do a thing, you have to understand that. So we are studying this out so we understand the word. And so our theme scripture is 2 Samuel 6:14-15. And we built upon that with reading 2 Samuel 6:14-23. And we went through and we talked about that last night. And now we're going to move on to 31, which says ways to praise. And the Lord gave me a, was it acronym? Acronym is the correct word. I hope so. That's what I've been saying the last couple of weeks. An acronym for praise. And the words that he gave me, or the letters rather, so when we say acronym, we mean we're taking one word and by the one letter in each of those words stands out for something that supports or defines or gives further understanding of that word or further description of that word. I have a visitor. And so we're going to talk about that tonight. We're going to go through praise, P-R-A-I-S-E. And we're going to talk about how we can recenter to what praise means. All right, so let's talk about the P in praise. When we see P, we can be reminded that when we are praising, there is purpose. There needs to be purpose to our praise. And what is the purpose of that praise? It says purpose to give God all that is within you. And so when we are praising, who are we praising? We're focusing our praise on God. We're giving God all the praise. It is possible to, just as I was opening up in prayer and I was talking about praising God, I said, thank you for waking me this morning. Thank you for showing up. Thank you for lifting and easing burdens. Thank you for just being you. So we can thank God when we give him praise, which is a form of approval or adoration. We can thank him for those things, but we have to be mindful to remember that when we praise, our focus of praise is God. It is showing our approval and expressing our adoration and admiration to God. So we always have to be reminded that the praise is focused on God and never the thing that God can get to us or gives us. It is God who is the giver. So it says, purpose to give God all that is within you. 2 Samuel 6:14, we talked about David wearing a linen ephod. I think when Mama Leslie told me last night, the E is silent. Wearing a linen ephod, David was dancing before the Lord with all his might. So when we have that P in purpose or praise and we purpose, we're going to remember to purpose to give God that is all that is within us. Praise comes from our heart. Praise, when we approve of something or we want to express our approval, it's like a small child. Or I'll give the example of my son. So my son has been doing, he's been homeschooling because of the closure of the schools due to the pandemic. And he really is knocking it out the park. He really is proving to be a student that just excels so much easier and focuses on his own instead of what seems to be a larger group setting. So we're rethinking some things. But he has gone from, you know, being a B, C student. B's are great, C's are okay. You know, I'm not gonna, you know, throw a fit if he makes a C, but when I know that he has a B and an A potential, then I'm gonna go, what's going on? But my son has raised his GPA and he, on this last progress report, he had all A's and one B. And to be totally honest, in the history of schooldom for him, you know, he's never made a B honor roll. And so, of course, we were really, really grateful for that. And I praised him. I told him how I expressed my approval and told him how proud I was of him. And I admired his efforts. And so I showed him verbally, I gave him an outward expression of my inward approval and adoration for him. And so God is the same way. When we want a purpose to express our praise to God, we do that verbally. We do it from within our heart. We tell God how much we adore him, how much we appreciate him, how much we love him. And so that's just a really good example of praise. We praise our children. We can praise different things, and we can just give them an outward expression of our inward emotions and feelings towards them. So I'm really, really proud of him for making that AB honor roll. Well, and actually it's just his progress report. So by the time report cards roll around, he should have all A's. And it's a major accomplishment for him because he's algebra. And one of the areas he's struggled in has been in math. And so for him to, you know, be pulling up with a B in algebra, I praised him. I'm really proud of him. So you think about that when you direct your praise to God. You're not praising the thing, you are praising God. And you praise and you can thank God for the thing, but he's the one that you keep your focus on. And even in that, my son has learned to give praise to God and say, you know, God help me with that. And I just talk to him and the Holy Spirit. So those are forms of praise as well. When we are giving recognition to the gifts and the abilities that God has given us. So purpose to give all that is within you. P, purpose. The next letter R is to restore. Restore God's presence in the atmosphere. So when we are praising, we started with that P, there is purpose. We are purposing to give God all that is within us. And then we are looking and seeking to restore God's presence in the atmosphere. We are telling God, I welcome you into this situation. I thank you for coming into this situation. I thank you for what you're going to do and how you're going to be in this situation. I just want to keep my heart's attitude. Remember, we talked about your posture, meaning your position. Your praise is a posture. When we go back to week one at the beginning of this, we talked about what these seven tacticals will achieve. And one of those things was, we talked about praise is an attitude. Some of these steps are actions, meaning you have to physically make effort to do these things. And then there are certain things that they're a heart attitude, meaning your heart has to be connected. You have to have your mind made up that in your heart, this is what you are going to do and how you're going to be. And so when you praise, that is a attitude of the heart. And the R in there is to restore God's presence in the atmosphere. What do you mean, Takiyah? Let's go a little bit further. So you could have had just an awful day. Nothing went right. You woke up this morning, your alarm clock didn't go off, so you're late. Getting the kids started for school. You were supposed to go do some grocery shopping. You had a doctor's appointment. It just set you all off. You got to your doctor's appointment late. They canceled the appointment. On the way home, you got a flat tire. You're just having a day of all days. On the exterior, you're probably a little bit through. You're probably a little bit just undone with your day, but when it comes to keeping focus on God, you can have a situation where you feel like, well, you know what? This is just really bad and I'm just feeling bad and I just want to stick with this. But if you can reach deep into your heart's attitude, your heart's posture and position, just to say, you know, God, you're still God and I thank you. Because even though the alarm clock did not wake me up on time, you still woke me up. Even though I got to the doctor's appointment late and I ended up getting a flat tire, I did not get into an accident. Whatever the situation is, it's what we call, what do they say? Seeing the silver lining in things. Prayer or praise, that heart attitude, your posture of praise, when you do that, you begin to show God that, you know what, no matter what is going on, I still have the ability to focus on you, and I want you to maintain your position in my life because I recognize that you are still God. It restores your presence. And as you do that, those things begin to become so minute. They are still things that need to be addressed, rightfully so, but you recognize and you rest in the fact that God is still your Father. And when you can ask him, it says he, I don't want to get ahead of it, but in one of our studies, we talk about how God inhabits the praises of his people, which inhabit, that means he comes in and he dwells and he lives there. So if you are keeping a position and a posture of praise, restore. That R is to restore. Okay, I was upset. This is going on. This is not going right. I'm just not. The R is for restore. Restore, or you can even say reset, but God gave me restore. Restore God's presence in the atmosphere. Don't let things get you all off of kilter, and don't forget to verbally tell God, I thank you because you're still God. And watch how fast he'll show up. Because when, think about it, when someone is appreciated, anything. You can look at your spouses, you can look at your children, you can look at yourself as a parent, as a mother, as a father. I keep saying I have a little visitor here. Hello. He just climbed up in my lap. You can look at yourself in any of those outlets. Whenever you show your spouse appreciation, they have no problem doing things for you. They start doing extra stuff for you. Whenever your children show you appreciation and gratitude, you have no problem doing things for them. You know that they desire that and that they're appreciative and grateful of you because you showed up. So the R is for restore God's presence in the atmosphere. And then let's look at that. That's 2 Samuel 6:16. And it says, as the ark of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. And when she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. Okay, that goes to what we're talking about. David was having a good day. He's having a great day. The ark of the covenant is coming into the camp. He's praising the Lord. And then boom, here's a naysayer. Here's her, as my friend calls it, a Debbie Downer. And she's watching him from the window and she just despises him in her heart. David had a heart's posture and position and attitude that no matter who was around him, no matter who was watching, no matter who was listening, no matter what was going to be said or spoken, he intended to restore God's presence into the atmosphere. He was welcoming that presence into the atmosphere. This is my daughter's cat, so we're in Colombia visiting her, and I have to keep swatting him away because he's gonna knock my whole little studio down going on here like a little child. All right, and then A is to, and he keeps biting my toes under the table, so if you see me, that's what's going on. And then we have A in the word praise is to adore. Adore the plans and purpose of God. Second Samuel 6:17 says, they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. So David, he adored the plans and purpose of God. He not only rejoiced and he purposed to praise with all that was in him. He restored the atmosphere. He was praising. Remember we talked about he just danced out of his clothes. He restored the atmosphere for God. He set it up and he restored it because the people caught a hold of it. And he just set the atmosphere. And now he's like, I'm going to pitch a tent. He's just basically, it's just like if somebody comes to visit your home, he's like, ooh, I have guests coming. Someone that you really just love or treasure or value. And you're like, I'm going to, you know, clean. Well, so I'm here visiting my daughter. I told her we were going to come down. She's like, hey, auntie. She's like, okay, I got to clean the house. I got to set up the bedroom. I got to do this. You know, I don't have any girl. You know, she's getting prepared. She's preparing because mama's coming. She's going to make sure she takes care of the house. David was doing the same thing for the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the presence of the Lord coming into the city of David. And so he began to get his house ready. He's like, let me pitch a tent. Let me sacrifice. He adored the things of God. He understood the plans of God and the purpose of God. And he knew that his praise was setting up for more of God's presence. So when you praise, you have to have a mindset to adore the things of God. You have to have a mindset that you just love the things of God and what God loves. So your praise is a position of adoration and adoring the plans and the purpose of God. Now, let's talk about that a little bit deeper, because sometimes many times God's plans are not our plans, but he always has purpose in the things that he calls us to do. And so does that necessarily mean we're going to like or love what he gives us to do? Absolutely not. I'm going to tell you that 275,000 billion quadrillion percent. We are not always going to like it. We are not going to always understand it, but we have to purpose to recognize that God has the best of intentions for us. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. They are higher than ours, but we adore the purpose of God because we know that in everything he does, there is purpose. And so we just have to continue to obey that. So adore, let your A in praise be adore the plans and purpose of God. And David did that. The I in praise is to inspire others around me. 2 Samuel 6:18. After he had finished sacrificing the burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord Almighty. Okay? So he blessed the people. So the I in praise is to remind you, my praise inspires others around me. Remember last night we talked about the mother of the church who she just was praising God. She was praising God. And I was standing there, you know, with stone feet and just a smug face, like, I ain't got nothing to praise God about. I'm just not in a good mood. And her praise inspired me. It inspired and it ignited me to give God worship. Because let me tell you, the number one thing about that is not only was her praise contagious and inspiring to me, but praise, again, remember, it restores God's presence in the atmosphere. It reminded me, wait a minute, Takiya, it doesn't matter what you went through today. It doesn't matter what happened, what they said, who did what, how it was done, why this didn't go right, what went awry. My praise isn't to any of these things. My praise is to the Creator. And I can thank him for every one thing that's gone wrong. You can find 10 reasons to give him praise because he is. And so your praise inspires others around you. So it says David blessed the people. He blessed them. It was a blessing for them to see. Now, of course, it was a blessing for them to see him honor his God, his Savior, or his Lord, rather. I remember we talked about he went before God. He suited up properly. He put on that linen ephod. And he went before God with the proper things. This joker is licking my toes, y'all. So, what's his name? Lilo. This is Lilo. And so he went before God and his praise inspired. Now, mind you, I'm sitting in a small corner in a two-story townhouse and he wants to come over here in the corner with me. It's the anointing, y'all. It's attractive. But anyway, so the S. Let's go to the S. So I is your praise. Be reminded that your praise inspires others. And then let's go to the S. S is it surrounds my environment and the settings. So I have inspired. I have, you know, just spoken and showed a thing. And now that thing, not only has it been inspiring and igniting, now it's going to begin like a ripple. Just remember we talked a couple of weeks ago, the Holy Spirit gave me the example of an atomic bomb. And we've all seen images of that. When that bomb goes off, it goes up like this huge cloud of smoke, and then it mushrooms and it just waves out. You know, we bind that in the name of Jesus. However, for visual purpose, just the way that it covered the land and spread out, your praise is like that. You have to understand that your praise is just going up to God, giving him glory, giving him the honor, thanking him, telling him how much you love him, telling him how much you adore him, telling him how much you need him, telling him how much you desire him. Just thank you, God, because you're good. Not even for anything you've done, but you are just God over everything, Lord over all. And I scared him. I just thank you. And as you do that, your praises are going up. And then they're mushrooming out almost like a sonic wave. It's just, you can't see what is going on, but it is just going out. Like, it makes me think of, I'm a huge Marvel comic fan. If you are a DC comic fan, don't come for me. I'm not a fan. I'm a Marvel comic fan. And I mean, me and Marvel comic go way back. I had sheets and all kind of stuff. But I'm a Marvel comic fan. So when I watch things like The Avengers or Wolverine or things like that, when you think about them and they have those superpowers, and you know, there's been plenty of scenes. I can't think of one particular movie, but they have that power and they just hold their hand out like that. And you see, you can't see anything, but you just kind of, the screen ripples. Your praise is doing that surrounding your environment and your settings. It is targeting and it is tapping and it is attacking certain things in the surrounding and the settings because you're sending it up to God. And it is vibrating out amongst the settings and the surroundings. So never negate or doubt your praise. So S surrounds your environment and your settings. And 2 Samuel 6:19 says, then he gave a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins to each person in the whole crowd of Israelites, both men and women. And all the people went to their homes. So David was able, because he had been blessed, he blessed the Lord, and apparently he had been blessed, and now he was able to be a blessing, and the people were inspired by that, and it says all the people. So your surroundings, your environment, your settings, it is going to impact all the people one way or the other, to the positive or to the negative, to the spiritual or to the soul. It's going to impact, inspire, and surround the environment one way or the other. And we go back to Michael in 2 Samuel 6:16. She despised it. It ain't got nothing to do with you. She despised it. She didn't understand it. She didn't recognize it. She didn't reverence it. The praise still impacted her. And she had a choice and a decision to make. But your praise will impact and inspire and reach your surroundings, your settings, and your environment. And then lastly, the E is to evoke. In praise, evoke. Your praise evokes others' purpose, praise, or position. So again, we're just going back to Michael. Let's talk about that. 2 Samuel 6:22. David said, I will become even more undignified than this, and I will be humiliated in my own eyes. But by these slave girls you spoke of, I will be held in honor. So regardless, we just talked about when you praise, your praise is going up and it is going to the one who is the, it is going to God, our creator, our father, whatever name you can think of that he is to you, it is all being focused on him. But as that praise is going up, it's sending out that sonic wave in the spiritual realm to impact and to inspire and to hit that environment and those settings. But it will also evoke purpose, praise, or position in others. So right here, what it evoked in Michael was it showed David her true heart's posture, her true heart's position, and it was not for the things of the Lord. It was not for the things of God. Now, we do one of two things with that. Because again, remember, the Lord is in your relationship with him. He's watching you and how you handle, how others treat, speak, and respond to you. And in your relationship, he's not worried about that. He's watching you. Now, in his relationship with them, he's watching them and how they treat, speak, respond. But in your personal relationship, when your praise evokes purpose, praise, or reveals posture and position of heart, let's say it be like Michael, David's wife, who decided to reveal that I don't have a heart for the things of God. I don't have a purpose or a passion for the things of God. Then we now are faced with a choice because again, God is watching how we treat others in our relationship with him. Either the Holy Spirit is going to direct you that this isn't something I wanted for you anyway. Their position has been revealed. Or a position is revealed for the purpose of, I need to pray. I need to intercede. God will lead you on how to handle those things. But your praise will evoke purpose, praise, or position in others. Because remember, you're surrounding the environment and you're impacting your settings and you are inspired. Now, when you inspire others, you are causing, again, we go back to that woman giving praise. She inspired me because she reminded me I had a heart of praise towards the Lord. And she reminded me, oh yeah, you know what? It's not about the things. Why am I letting something steal my praise? My praise belongs to God. Let me sacrifice a praise. So when we inspire, that is for the purpose of reminding others that you give God praise. Now, when we evoke, again, that is going to be a revelation of purpose, praise, or position. And in this, what David found out was it revealed Michael's position. And so how he dealt with that, again, I talked about this last night. I just love it. He says, I will become even more undignified. You will not stop my praises because your heart position isn't right. And so he also evoked in the latter part of that, he says, but by the way, the slave girls that you spoke of, the ones who you're telling me are under me and you're attempting to make it sound as if I'm vile, vulgar, and humiliated to them, they're gonna hold me in honor. They recognized that I reverence the Lord God Most High. And because of their heart position, because they saw their king become servant to the king, I'm evoking purpose and praise and a posture and position of praise in them. So you check your heart attitude. So you evoke others' purpose, praise, or position. And so that was just something that the Lord gave me. Again, as we go through 2 Samuel 6:14 and 23, a reminder as to when you are praising, purpose, restore, adore, inspire, surround, and evoke. And again, be reminded that our praise is not about the thing. It's not on the thing. Our praise reminds us and restores our focus on the one who created the thing. Because understand this, no matter what the thing is, purpose, place, thing, people, good, bad, negative, positive, friend, foe, enemy, sister, mother, brother, lover, whatever it is, whatever. The creator of all of that, the one who can handle all of that, he's the one we give praise to. He's the one we give thanks to. He's the one we give our approval, adoration, and admiration to. And as you're doing that, your heart attitude begins to shift back onto him. And he says, and remember we talked about when he shows up, he draw nigh unto him and he will draw nigh unto you. He dwells in the praises of his people. He's our Abba. He's our daddy. So again, we talked about last week when we think about God and who he is and all that he is, and we're praising him for that. When he comes to see us, he comes to see us in the form of what we're praising him for. You need Abba. You need daddy. You need me to be a father to you. Hug on my baby girl. Tell you everything's going to be okay. Who did it? What do I need to make right? You need a healer. You need me to be a doctor. You need to be a surgeon. Miraculously manifest your healing. Take away this tumor that others said couldn't be done. You need me to be your comforter. You praising me as your comforter. You praising me because you need rest, because you're weary. You're praising me because you need me to lift a burden, because I'll carry it. You praising me, you know, whatever you praise, again, the praise is on him. It's never about the thing, but we have to recognize, we have to know who we are going before, because God himself asked me, it was rhetorical, because he wanted me to get it to you all, Takiyah. How will they know how to receive from me if they don't know who I am? So as you are praising, praise him for who he is and how he is, and not focus on the what he can do, but again, who he is, because he is God, he is Lord, he is Savior over all. All right, we got that, ladies? Let us look at, what is the next worksheet? That was 31, 30, 31, print it 32, I skipped 32. So let me go into 32 here for a moment. Un momento, por favor. He is I am. That's right. He is I am. And I love calling him I am too. When you just think about that and you think on I am, I love how God says I am that I am, because it is infinite in its statement, meaning you can put anything behind I am. I am your healer. I am your strength. I am your peace. I am your protection. It's all the names of God that we talked about. But then he leaves it open-ended also, because he says, I am. I don't need. I'm the beginning and the end. You can stick and insert any word you want in there, but baby, I am. And I love that name of God, because he just is. All right, what's going on with my intranet? I'm trying to get you. I printed, for some reason I skipped worksheet number 32. I have 33, so I'm gonna pull it up digitally. There we go. My internet shut down for a minute, but we're back up. We are back up. So let's look at worksheet number 30. So tell me while I'm pulling that up, tell me some of the names of God, ladies, that viewers, that you refer to God as. Not only that you refer to him as, but tell me who he really is to you. Not cliche, not what you've heard other people call him, but tell me some of the names. Give me a name, type something in there. Tell me who God is to you as I'm pulling this up. We're talking about him being the great I am. Who do we praise him as? Adore. What aspect of God do you really, really adore him as? Do you really, just when you are in a state of praise and worship, who do you really know him as? For me, you all know it's Abba. He's my daddy. He is my daddy, my diddy. All right, where are we at? We are on praise. Praise, praise, praise. Worksheet number 32. Okay. It's funny. So I'm visiting my daughter. My kids are sitting in the background and they both have headphones on and they have to be quiet. I mean, they could have went in any other room. I guess I could have went in another room, but they told me my time was limited because they don't know how long they can be quiet. But they both have headphones on, listening to music and doing stuff. And I'm like, y'all better not say a word while I'm filming. All right, worksheet number 32. So my son's on PlayStation, my daughter's on a laptop. I hadn't seen my daughter in almost 2 months, so because of this whole quarantine thing, but also because she moved a couple of hours away, she transferred schools, and so I'm excited to see her. Worksheet number 32, free write. We've done this before. All right, it says, if I were able to put into words all my expressions of adoration, love, and admiration towards God, my Father, Jesus, my Savior, and the Holy Spirit, my helper, I gave you three of them right there, what would I say? How do I love them? How do I adore them? What do I admire about them? Now, I just asked you, I said, while I'm pulling up worksheet 32, because I don't have it, I said, I haven't seen anybody type anything, but I said, tell me who God is to you. Now, isn't this interesting? This is the worksheet. That's exactly what we're about to do. So God is just so amazing. I see him in everything. I don't know about you all, but I just am always so excited about the smallest affirmation and confirmation that I am going down the right path with God, that I'm hearing from him, that he's talking to me. There we go. They're popping up. My healer. I'm always like, I'm like, ooh, I heard from God. Ooh, that was God. You know, so I'm always so excited about it. There we go. My provider. So it says, meditate and think on these words collectively as the Trinity, meaning God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. So what do they all mean to you, three in one? And then individually, like we just said, God my Father, Jesus my Savior, and the Holy Spirit my helper. There we go, my comforter. Respectively to their roles in my life, and free write my thoughts, feelings, and emotions. Remember, free write, we don't premeditate on it. We just write it all out. Whatever's here that manifests here, we just spill it all out. We just write it. So we're writing, and you can categorize. You can write God my Father, Jesus my Savior, the Holy Spirit my helper, because that helps you to understand each of their respective roles, because each of them have respective roles, but then collectively they work together as well. So you can do that. You can write out each three, and then you write out the Trinity, how they work, how you see them all together and what they do for you, you know, when you give that adoration to them together. So this is a free write exercise. It's kind of like we did our vision board or our vision worksheets in week one? I think it was week one, surrender. So we do the same thing here. You can jot, you can draw words, you can write them out, you can doodle them, you can cut and paste words, you can put hearts, you can put musical notes. Just what do you think? You know, how do you give adoration? What do you feel? It's like writing a love letter. Remember when we was in school? Do you like me? Check yes. Check no, check maybe. You know, when we was like in second grade. You know, but we're writing. And then as you got into like middle school and stuff, you know, you folded it all elaborately and you're like, you know, pick blue and open this here. And, you know, then it was like this, you know, I like you. Do you want to go to the dance with me? And, you know, I wasn't fast. I didn't write a boy's letter or nothing like that. You know, I don't recall. I don't think so. But, you know, so we're going to write a love letter to God, and we're not asking him for anything. We're not wanting anything other than to praise him, to adore him, to admire him. Jesus, Holy Spirit, we just want to write and just write them a love letter. Just free write. If it's sentences, if it's one word, if again, if you want to clip out things, just go for broke and just, you know, let God. I see like the little, even the, I see, you know, we have our little emojis on iPhones, the praise hands and the fire, you know, things like that. What if you don't have words, draw it out, write it out, sketch it out. Just, we're going to give God a love letter and just tell him why we praise him, because, or how we feel about him, what is in our heart that we just want to get out. Remember, we're not asking for anything. We're not focusing on the things that we need taken care of. We are focusing on the one who takes care of us, who takes care of all things. All right. So that is your assignment tonight. That's where, oh, look, and scroll to the bottom of that. I said I didn't want to get ahead, but that's perfect. That lines up. God is so good. Psalm 22 and 3, and I put the King James Version because I did go back and I read between the NIV, I think I read the Amplified, and I just, it said different things, but I just really like the KJV on this one. It says, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Inhabit, it just, let me give you a definition on that really quickly so you can have a visual on what that means. When you praise God, remember, we are restoring the atmosphere. You are positioning yourself in a posture of praise, and you are setting, you're telling him who you are. But what is inhabit? It says to live in or occupy a place or environment. Live in, settle, populate, colonize. I love for God to settle and live in and dwell where I am. It says you inhabit the praises of Israel. We're children, we're an extension of, we're what's it called? Ancestors, generations, it's not the word I want. We are descendants of the children of Israel. And so we are God's people. We are his chosen people. You know, we want to get into a big old debate about that. When Jesus came, I chose him, he chose me. I am his chosen people. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabits, that sets up, that lives, that dwells in my praises. So when I am just praising you and telling you I love you and I adore you, I'm going to live here. I am going to set up camp and I'm going to live here with Takiya. And anything that comes Takiya's way, it has to come through me first. So just meditate on that scripture as you talk about how much you love him tonight. whatever, you know, again, be reminded, we want to focus on telling him, not going to him before anything, but just speaking of our love of him. So I'm going to do that tonight as well. And then we'll meet back here tomorrow, same time, 7 p.m. on live. And that's our assignment for tonight. I am going to go ahead and close out in prayer, as I always do. I'm going to offer the prayer of salvation. Let's go to Romans 10, 9 and 10. I'm going to read that for anyone that does not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. You know what? I'll pull it up here. Will I pull it up here? And accepting Christ is very simple, but so profound and so powerful. It literally is life-changing.